broadcasting from the far side of Enceladus, beaming in at the speed of light across the vast chasms of space, streaming directly into your brain. You're listening to the Spartacast League. I am Faolan, and joining us today are Attica, Fibersinthe, and Eno. So get ready and strap in, because tonight we're talking racial profiling in the police state. We begin tonight with white people not minding their own business, calling the cops on people of color and accosting them. And today, we've seen that not even the military and our veterans are immune to this. There was a case in Houston here where a 23-year-old named Jalen Bell was beaten by security guards or bouncers who yelled racial epithets at him as they kicked him out, and they just totally beat him down.
How do we even begin with this? Because to unpack this, you first have to acknowledge that a lot of the veneer we have about our troops, I mean, we hear a lot about this from the more patriotic side of our politics. It's like, we always respect the troops. Like, it transcends race and class. If you're a troop, you're protected, you get all these benefits and discounts, you go down to the movie theater, hell, you get $2 off your ticket. This guy, his veteran's benefit was he walked into two skinheads as he was leaving the bar after he ended up in the wrong side of a bar. He walked into a VIP area. Some guy put out his cigarette in his drink, yelled at him. And then as he left, he was accosted by these security guards and had the shit kicked out of him. I mean, the guy is wearing a neck brace, right? And yeah, he was a troop. You know, like, he didn't start this. These guys started the violence on him. And that's one of the unfortunate things about American politics, is it doesn't matter what your class is. Our society is so fucking racist sometimes that if you're black, then you are just black in that moment. And that's how people are going to view you. And you are going to be visited by some of the most hateful people in the world for nothing other than the color of your skin. I know that's not a radical thing to say, but it's something that happens monthly, daily. I mean, it's a plague.
We have so many examples this week of racial profiling happening. And this particular case, this is the high profile case that happened because, you know, somebody got beaten within an inch of their life.
Because he
was military, but also because of the severity of it. I think even if he wasn't military, it would have gotten airplay. But we had a supposedly nervous mom call the police on Native American teens at Colorado State University just because they wouldn't answer her questions to her satisfaction. So she got upset with them and called the cops on them, and then said that they were from Mexico. They were wearing clothes with symbols on them and everything, and she was just scared. After that, we had the situation with the woman calling the police on three African-American women who were renting a B&B room, and they sent out the helicopter and six officers to deal with that situation, also because they refused to acknowledge and wave at her.
And it wasn't even her who was renting the Airbnb. It was a neighbor who, like, didn't recognize these people. And because they were black, that was a problem. And that's a thing. Like, I've broke down on my scooter before and I had to pull into, like, this white suburb. And, like, over the course of the hour and a half for waiting in the tow truck, literally two-thirds of the houses, an angry white guy stood out on his porch, stared me down, folded his hands and went "Hrumph" before going inside.
Yeah, and you're not supposed to be in that neighborhood because you don't have enough money. Actually, I have a suburbia story. Back when I moved up to Oregon, originally in 2007, I rented out a place that was in this suburb up in the north west corner of Eugene, and it was kind of a new neighborhood. The houses were going for like triple figures up there, but somebody needed some money, so they rented out a room, and I was fortunate enough to answer the ad and everything. And I get in there day two, I crap you not, I'm walking to Walmart and I'm trying to find my way home and everything. And this guy approaches me and says, "We can't have you in our neighborhood," because I wasn't dressed appropriately. They were like, they did not believe that I was from that area or that I was living in that area. And so you could only imagine how it would be if you were a person of color or something like that, where you actually have a permanent visual cue as to what you are.
there are places in Arizona where, like, I don't see black people ever, like, shopping or in a store, or they know if they go there and try to walk into that Bed Bath & Beyond or whatever, some worker, honestly, more likely it'll be some mom in there will tell some worker that they have to raise a big deal out of it, but call security, and security will come and throw them out. Or just call the police. Like, it's so dangerous. Like, I wonder how black people even manage to leave the house.
Yeah, and I mean, if that's one thing that white people love to do, it's call the police. Like, no matter what it is, like, they see a bit of litter on the road, and they're like, 911, there's litter.
So
They're barbecuing! The audacity! I gotta call the police! Did you guys see that, by the way?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Since our list of topics was made, there's been like two more of these. There's been she was something involved with the college, and she called the police on her neighbors because they were having a barbecue. And then there was a lawyer in Manhattan who screamed racial stuff at Hispanic fast food workers. It's just, it's everywhere, and it happens so fast we can't keep up with it. And the most real talk, the saddest thing is that everyone's pretending this is new because of Trump. The only reason any of this shit is getting any kind of news time is because of Trump. This shit happened daily under Obama, and it was just pretend it doesn't happen, racism's over.
In addition to Trump, is that more and more people not only have cell phones, but they're pulling them out and recording things.
Oh, yeah. And more black people and Mexican people are just fed up with it. You know, when Trump is president, there's not much more waiting for white people to get it you can do. You just kind of got to not care about it, whether there's going to be bad Facebook comments or not. You just got to be done with it and deck the fucker who's calling you the N-word. You can be called outrageous and not the right time or not how to deal with it. Your tactics are too violent or whatever by all the centrists who wouldn't leave Twitter for a free sandwich, let alone lift a finger for any kind of justice. So at that point, you just say screw it and you raise hell about it.
Yeah, I don't know if raising a fist would have helped our boy Jalen, but I think that...
Well, the Second Amendment might have.
Yeah, you know, if he was carrying, although in a nightclub.
That is true, because I could spin the story the other way, too. So you definitely do have to pick and choose your battles whenever a gun is involved.
Can you imagine the story on Breitbart? It would be like, armed thug terrorizes fucking ecstasy nightclub in Dallas.
All these people that keep calling the police, they're also the same people that like support the police state and support the police and all this stuff. And I don't see how it is supportive of the police to make a false report and put somebody's life at risk that's going to be responding, because for all you know and all they know, they might actually have a gun and do decide to defend themselves, and they're within their rights to do so. There's been multiple court cases that have upheld that you can defend yourself from the police if they're violating your rights.
A lot of times people who make that call know that it's bullshit. There was a black guy who made a U-turn into a neighborhood. Not even the barbecue. Today, there was a black guy who made a U-turn into a neighborhood, and this angry woman comes up to him, questioning him, why, who are you, what are you doing here, and like at the window of his car, he's just trying to drive away, and as he's driving away, she whips out her phone and films him, and she goes, gun, he's got a gun, call the police, don't you draw that gun on me. They're gonna treat you like you have a gun whether you have one or not. And then there's the clueless type of person who just called the police because they've never stopped to think, hey, wait a minute, what are the police actually doing? I had a neighbor across the way who was gay, and the neighbors below him are an African refugee. I think they're all brothers. There's like three of them, and they live downstairs. And God forbid they have a party that carries on to midnight on Saturday nights. Right, God forbid they do a damn human thing and live a little. And he calls the police on them for a noise complaint. It's like, you know how many times the police have rolled up for a noise complaint and left a dog or a child somewhere, someone dead? All the damn time. And people don't think. Like, I never, ever call the police. Because they're not going to come and do anything for me. They're probably just going to come and shoot me.
Or your cat.
Yeah, or my cat, my dog.
Well, they would shoot your cat, because didn't you say your cat was black?
I made that joke to a cop once, and they laughed. And I'm like, I don't know what's worse, the fact that I made that joke or the fact that you're laughing.
I feel like we might need to unpack a little bit about cop behavior. This is my experience, and maybe you guys can corroborate this, but cops genuinely find it funny when you talk about things that criticize them and their work, because they think that they know better than you on how to police. They've gone through these pretty extreme training rituals where they're like, stop and frisk all the people who look gangster-like, and, you know, shoot them, that's fine. Like, when I shoot a...
They're like any supposed expert, in my opinion. So if you were to say things critical about your doctor might, you know, laugh at you and say, you know, haha, that's pretty funny. I think that there is a certain level of that when it comes to the cops as well. And it's just an arrogance.
Yeah, it's unfortunate that my doctor hasn't killed my dog or something, so I would have the opportunity to criticize him for it. not to say that a cop has shot my dog, but yeah, sure.
Yeah, but when your doctor kills someone, like, they get in trouble. When the police kill someone, it's just called doing their job, and they get away completely scot-free. Or they're forced to resign, and then they go to L.A.
Oh, my God, the LAPD. But I know you had something to add?
But I have some degree of experience in this. My father was a sheriff's deputy for 12 years, and he shared a lot of his experiences with me. And typically in a very cop-like way, in a very self-assured way, and knowing a lot about their training system at that time in that area, and knowing a lot about their practices at that time and in that area, I have a particularly ugly view of the police, kind of from the inside. One of the things that we talked about today, in fact, he called me today and I was discussing the Mento video with him and how dangerous that is for someone like me, because had I been in that situation, I would have killed that man because he drew before identifying himself as police. So we went over the escalation of force procedures for most police departments. Many police departments swear by the same escalation of force procedures. Do you know anything about them?
Yeah, there's a certain protocol that they have to follow before drawing a weapon, that there has to be a certain level of danger, correct?
Yes. In a lot of cases, you can skip over a couple of the steps if things escalate too quickly. But basic escalation of force is level 1, presence of officer. Level 2, officer issuing verbal commands. Level 3, back in the 90s, it was whomping people with your battle stick or trying to get them in a chokehold or whatever, but that has been replaced more recently by chemical weaponry, which is your OC spray or your mace or your tear gas grenade. Level 4 is naturally your whomping stick, those typically collapsing batons, sometimes the modified tonfa. Level 5 is less lethal weapons, such as tasers or flexible baton rounds out of a shotgun. And finally, level 6 is lethal. That's drawing your sidearm or going to your car to get your primary if the situation calls for it. Now, in a lot of situations, they'll have to skip over a couple of those steps. The personal safety of the officers involved, I'm sure.
Yeah, it would be interesting to know just how many cases are dismissed because the officer had a, quote, like, credible threat to their personal safety. That's one of those weasel phrases that I hear a lot when it comes to police officers being put on trial, is that when they're put in front of a jury and they sort of get teary-eyed and say, oh, I was worried I would never see my daughter again, so I drew my gun. Like, juries love that shit and eat it up. And
well, it's an appeal to emotion.
Well, another thing that they do to be able to search you without a warrant or your permission and blow through your rights is by saying very audibly, so it can be heard by the dash cam, I think I smell pot. And then they have probable cause to just tear your car apart and arrest you for whatever the hell they want.
Yeah, there was a time where I got pulled over by a state patrol because I I didn't get in an accident. I hit like a bit of water and like my car swerved, you know, and I had pulled to the side of the road to just calm down. And I got the boop boop, you know, like I got pulled over. And the first thing the cop asked me, he didn't ask me, are you okay? He didn't ask for my license or registration. He asked, how much you been drinking? They really want to nail you on something so that they can like get you with an arrest. That has been something that I see consistently.
Which is,
and they literally have arrest quotas to fill. They have to arrest a certain amount of people to justify their budget. So it's ass backwards policing to where they invent a crime to be able to arrest you for, so it fills up the quota and fills up a jail cell in a private prison that you can be worked for a little bit, rather than actually about being stopping anything.
Which is why anytime any of these people, whether it's a racial profiler, it's a citizen calling the police, or if it's the police, you should not answer questions, especially if they could be used to incriminate you.
Well, in his case, should he have said, "I haven't been drinking," because he hadn't been drinking. Okay, he had just been silent.
In the event that something could be used to incriminate you, you should not answer the question. I mean, that's just common sense.
Yeah, I mean, if the cop wanted to, I'm sure he could have made me run a breathalyzer. Totally, like, in shock state, could have had me, like, do the drunk test. And I might have even failed, because, I mean, I was shaking after it. Like, it was pretty horrible. Hit a gigantic puddle of water out of nowhere and lose control. But I just remember, like, seeing the cop and being like, there was that thought where I was like, this could be a moment where I'm like, oh, thank God. But I held my breath. And when the first thing out of his mouth was trying to book me for something, it was like a real letdown. Because people always talk about how cops are there to save you. And that clearly wasn't the case for me. I mean, maybe he had something to protect from. I totally understand that.
The cops have run wild this week. We had, and this was a case that really got Attica on this one, because it's something that could happen to a lot of people within the furry fandom here, was that a mentally ill Milwaukee man was tased 18 times in the shower and died, and the police were just doing a wellness check.
That means someone literally called the police on this mentally ill guy because they were worried for his safety, given that maybe he just wasn't even picking up the phone because he was in the shower. And they bust in the door, find him, and tase him to death and kill him. I read this story, I saw the pictures, and I went right to a free chat room and was like, don't ever call the police on a welfare check. They will just come and kill whoever you care about. At worst, or at best, scare them into agreeing to come with them, in which they'll dump them in a county prison overnight, or like at the police station, just dump them in a cage or dump them in the county health facility, where they'll just be berated by a whole bunch of people with worse mental illness until they're thrown out in the morning and said, don't come back. And that's what's going to happen when you do a wellness welfare check. The police have no interest in helping anyone. If you can't tell by the thin blue lion Punisher skulls they drive around with in their car, they're not looking to help people. They're looking to kill you, and they want any reason to, and they'll invent it if they have to.
On the subject of quotas, another gem from my father. Bear in mind, he was sheriff's department, not metropolitan police for any city area. He told me at one point, no, the sheriff's department doesn't have an explicit quota, but it has something a little bit worse than a quota. It has what you would call social pressure. Now, while they won't hand you a piece of paper or send you an invite or an invoice that says you need this many arrests, this many tickets, this many whatevers by the end of the month, you'll be sitting there in the chow hall and someone will offhandedly, all too casually, mention, oh, you know, Lieutenant Stevenson, he pulled in three junkies and shut down a whole fin meth lab last week. And in that way, it produces a very oppressive air of social pressure wherein every single sheriff or sheriff's deputy feels a need to outperform everyone around them, or they won't climb the ladder, as they say. In order to put food on the table, suffice to say, you need to be absolutely ruthless. And that, depending upon how you look at it, could be better or worse than a quota. It doesn't explicitly ask you to be a monster, but it allows people who are of dangerous mindset to climb very high, very quickly. And it trains people who are more reasonable to become people who have a very dangerous mindset and a very dangerous way of trying to do what they think is their job.
And then there are really, really small towns, which basically they only exist as speed trap towns, where within a moment's notice, you'll have to decelerate from going 90 on the freeway to crawling through the town at 25. And they're there waiting every day for the people who do that. And they just take it, take it, take it, take it, take it. And that's what funds the town. Because God forbid we actually give funding to the cities and towns in our society. No, they have to literally do it by preying upon travelers and giving them useless tickets that they totally set them up to fail for.
The military needs those tax dollars, obviously.
so that they can go and kill people in other countries. The entirety of the economy is set up to be a game of loss. When I was young, capitalism was explained to me as this great thing because, you know, before when money was just a physical piece of metal, the only way you could have money was if someone else didn't have money. And now with capitalism, because money isn't based on metal and it's all a fiat currency and it's all free trading, someone else doesn't have to have money in order for you to have money. But that's still true, because in order for you to have money, somebody else has to have a shit day or a shit life and go without, be hungry, get a ticket for no damn reason. And that's the entire way that our neoliberal economy is established and developed, to where people literally have to prey on each other and kick each other down the ladder for not even what was like 50 years ago, the nice middle class dream of the wife, the dog, and the white picket fence. But today is just fucking dinner. And 20 years from now will literally just be a tent.
Yeah, the law in its majestic equality forbids the rich as well as the poor to sleep under bridges, beg in the streets, and to steal bread. I think that's how the saying goes.
Yeah. To bring it back, though, the last cop story that I wanted to go into, the assault of Desmond Morrow, who was a former NFL player. I guess you could call it that because he played in like one game in 2012. So he wasn't a great NFL player. We're not talking legendary quarterback here. But nonetheless, this guy, and I saw the video, he complied with every order of the officers on tape. And they still dragged him down to the ground and beat him. So even if you comply, this just shows you that when the cops show up, that they're going to do what they're going to do. From what I gather in the story is that he was actually being harassed by some white nationalists. He threw a Coke can at them to stop them while they were on the road. And then the white nationalists pursued them. And then cops were called. And so they came in, they arrested him, and he complied with all of their orders. And he was still assaulted.
There's no rule of law for the police anymore. They can just do whatever they want. They get caught, there's a legal wiggle room out of it. They're the enforcement of the law. They uphold what the courts decide. The courts are never going to convict them. They're supposed to enforce the law, but yet be accountable to the law, which is an impossibility, is a contradiction in and of itself. So they are the law. You know, they can do whatever they want.
And the law!
Oh, God. Yeah. I mean, to just add to that, I mean, most police officers have become what Judge Dredd was parodying. But on top of that, like, I think a very important thing for leftist politics is to just dispense with the notion that if you comply with the police, that you'll survive. And we need to make the narrative, like, it doesn't matter if you comply or not, you will get beat by the cops if they choose to. I mean, we had a great example of this for white folks when that man was killed in a hotel hallway by the guy with the gun that had "You're fucked" engraved on the side of it, right?
Oh, that was like, in Arizona, right?
That was in my city, and I pretty much went on strike for it. I left the building I was in, and I went and I sat in my car the whole day and just sort of stared.
Did
up
you
in
see?
The
did you see like the picture of the guy that did it too? Because he looked like one of those like limp-wristed, nerdy 4chan posters.
Yeah, that's exactly who and what he was.
Did you see his shoulders? Oh, he was a nerdy 4chan poster who got a gym membership in a lottery.
No, I didn't see his shoulders. I don't pay too much attention to the details of dudes' physiques. It's just not my thing.
I'm sorry, I'm not checking out the oppressing class. I'm merely paying attention to details that are critical to oppressed people the world over.
Oh man, cop furry porn really bothers me.
No,
like,
stop.
I could barely keep my mouth shut at BLFC when all of the German shepherds formed a police dog unit and went around in like costume police gear. It really took everything not to like scream at them from across the hallway.
It's just like, could you just please stop?
They would go up to random fursuiters, grab them, and have the fursuiters scream like police brutality. And I just sort of was looking on like, the fuck are you doing?
It's not a joke.
This is a joke.
Like, this is the spectacle.
People are
right?
Dying daily from this. You stupid, toothless furry, stop.
This is how people internalize just the daily pillaging of our society and our cultural norms by basically our version of the Cossacks, right? We internalize it by being like, oh man, police brutality.
Well, this is
so crazy if that happened to me, right?
I wanted it to happen. Like, I wanted them to come up to me and grab me and try to do shit to me. I would have legit started throwing punches. I would have said, back the fuck off. And then, what are you doing wrong? Except, like, I thought, like, oh God, what if one of them actually is a cop? And could you imagine that? Like, the headline reading that? Police dog fursuiter arrests communist fursuiter who's acting, you know, police dog is actually a cop and actually does a real arrest because the fursuiter was resisting the fake arrest. And I foresaw that headline, and that's why I kept my fucking mouth shut.
No joke there that white supremacists have infiltrated law enforcement, and there are multiple FBI reports. There was one in 2007 that they did, and then they did another one 10 years apart from it, basically coming to the same conclusion. And the FBI still doesn't really want to take it with too much seriousness. And the first time that they did it back in 2007, I actually remember that one because I remember the backlash of right-wing commentators saying, they're going after our veterans and police! I mean, that was literally the talking point there. And yes, it was from Alex Jones.
Yeah, the one thing that I'm very grateful for about left-wing politics is, like, when you say FBI, you don't have to explain why they're bad. After the, you know, the political assassinations of the 60s, all of leftist discourse has included the fact that the FBI are filled with anti-communist radicals. I mean, they're our internal intelligence service, right? They surveil and slaughter us when we get out of line in a way that actually threatens the existing state apparatus.
The lineage of the FBI, actually, if you trace it back far enough, it goes back to the private Pinkerton firms along with the Secret Service.
That's not surprising.
But the reason I bring this up, though, is because the police don't seem to have a handle on this, obviously, because of their history, where they came from, and just the fact that it's well known that white supremacists about 10 years ago did decide, hey, let's not be skinheads, let's grow our hair out and join the police, which is literally what the article, I believe, from The Intercept actually said, and it was really great. And if you're listening and you have time to go read something, I would say read those articles. There's a great one by The Root, a great one by The Intercept, and a great one from PBS NewsHour. All corroborate the same thing. And it's obvious as to why they would do this, because this is how they allow their base to expand. They infiltrate law enforcement so that law enforcement doesn't go after white supremacist groups. And they also get the bonus of unequally enforcing the law on people of color at the same time.
Yeah, there's something really canny. Another thing is, like, white supremacists are incredibly fucking canny. The ones that are just, like, MAGA chuds or impossible to reason with tiki torches or whatever, those guys are the foot soldiers. Career white supremacists care much more about expanding their network of racists and living comfortably within the middle class or above. They have no problem spending 10 or 20 years creating a litany of what we would probably consider on the left racially biased crimes or bending the rules, but they live on this stuff. It's their bread and butter. Infiltrating law enforcement is maybe the most canny move white supremacists have ever done, because they actually get to have a taste of the monopoly of violence that the state has, and they've used it fantastically.
So all of BLFC and running up to BLFC, I was in all the BLFC chats, and so was this guy who changes his name all the time, currently going as Fenegod, whose name is Tom. And Tom is an alt furry and tried to join Adam Waffen and put a gun to his girlfriend's head, beat her, and raped her. And is the best I have ever seen at pretending to be a good, nice boy. And he gets all the admins on his side and makes friends with everyone. And they're good at this. His dad owns a car dealership. He has literally grown up knowing how to perfect the nice guy, but I'm really a sleazy asshole look. That is where they excel, is at being the nice guy that no one would ever suspect. He's nice that they can get black friends who they can hold up and say, I'm not racist, I have a black friend, that they just exploit like none other, and that's the only reason why they're friends with them.
It's all about creating a veneer. You create this image That way, you make it look like the accusation is ridiculous on the surface of things. And that's how they always work. They always work through mystification. Actually, it's great that you mentioned Adam Woffen, because kind of going into like the subject of the police have this problem that isn't being taken care of, but for somehow, some way, the U.S. military has their own investigation going of an Adam Woffen member right now going on. It was Lance Corporal Vasilios Pistolis. I don't know how this is pronounced. It's Greek.
I mean, first things first, I just want to say, based off of the age of this Lance Corporal, he's 18 and he's already been outed. I have to bet that if we had an over-under, I would probably put my bet on ROTC. He was a member of ROTC and just became like an NCO straight into the military. I mean, after basic, I don't think this guy has actually seen anything rigorous at all.
That like, would sure be my guess.
His way in through all sorts of shady methods.
Like I said, they're good at being the nice guy and making friends with everyone.
Oh my god, and he's a water support technician. If I look that up...
he's the stormtrooper who knows how to replace a toilet main.
Of course.
I know what that is. That's your running the water works on the ship. It's a great job. He has to make sure that the water is pure, but not pure so much as to leach the minerals from your bones. Because that's an issue with water purity on ships. You can actually have too pure water.
So there's a joke from Clerks in which Randall is talking to Dante and he's talking about the second Death Star and how there were civilian contractors and shit and they all got killed. And he's like, you think your average stormtrooper knows how to replace a toilet main? And that's literally what this guy is. He's the stormtrooper who replaces the toilet main.
Well, they have to have somebody doing it. Otherwise, well, oh, yeah, that's right. We do have people that we spend millions of dollars on for contractors, wasting God knows how much in billions of dollars. Jeez.
I know, that's the thing, right? Is do you choose the Nazi or do you choose the scab?
Right.
I mean, that's the hell world we live in, is you can either choose the Nazis with protection or those independent contractors you could take a gamble on.
Well, I
think... And, you know, they did that. They started the independent contractor thing because of the labor resistance to manufacturing Pinochet's military. In Britain, there was all-out strikes. Like workers just refused to build the planes and the tanks for this guy. They just stopped working. And they weren't able to get it done. So they couldn't rely on regular factories to do it. So they had to build companies like Lockheed Martin that were basically just private extensions of the military. So they didn't have to worry about that bullshit.
Taking it back here, I do find it amazing, though, that the military is willing to take on this problem and do something about it. It goes to show that the FBI could do something about the police problem in this country if they wanted to. But they have chosen not to do it. They've chosen not to pursue it because a bunch of right-wingers sat there and got into a hissy fit about us targeting domestic terrorists, which is what they are.
So the FBI has jurisdiction over all American land to enforce federal crimes, but do they actually have jurisdiction over police themselves? Like, can an FBI literally walk up to a county cop and say you're fired?
No, they can't say they're fired, but they can put them under arrest.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, they can investigate police departments, and they do. It's just they don't typically investigate for those kind of things. I actually think that the FBI has the tools that should really be a part of what they do. They really need to crack down on law enforcement and other agencies that are extending their bounds and essentially violating the law, because that's exactly what they're doing in this particular case.
And if they don't, it'll get solved anyway, because the longer you keep the lid on the pot, the more pressure builds, and pressure
exactly.
is building. Literally a bunch of people, I don't want to say a bunch of Antifas, because then I sound like I don't know what I'm talking about. A bunch
of
people.
Some of our proud Antifa super soldiers, yeah, don't disrespect them.
Some of our proud Antifa super soldiers went to an ICE picnic. Like, just the idea of ICE having a picnic is hilarious. But they went to one and they literally smoked them out. Either authority can be responsible for itself. And you know what? You see this replicated all the way down to conventions. either authority can use its authority to defend the public safety, or they have to look the other way when the public does it themselves. But right now, they're trying to do both. And all that does is create a more desperate situation that explodes at some point. The convention, BLFC, didn't do anything about Tom following around his girlfriend, his ex-girlfriend, who fucking fled the state from him, following her around the convention and intimidating her. Didn't do shit. But yet they also were banning from chats and threatening to punish anyone who did anything to this Tom person. All authority replicated down to the very most stupid joke of authority of convention security has this problem, where they will neither use their authority to protect the people that are the reason why they have the authority, and they won't look the other way when people do it themselves and solve the problem themselves. And they need to pick one and do one or the other.
And you hit
or
the...
they're just going to not have authority. Like, one day they're going to wake up and people are just going to have overthrown them, you know, revolution, and they're going to go, what happened? Well, you know, you wouldn't let us solve the problem, so we had to get rid of the dumbass centrist ass who wouldn't let anything happen or do anything.
And you hit the nail on the head there, is that if the government refuses to do anything about it, it puts it into the hands of the citizens who will eventually do something. We saw it with Ferguson, and my estimation is it's going to happen again, probably this year. And it's going to be even worse. Everything that you saw in Ferguson is going to happen again, and it's just going to be magnified because the problem hasn't been solved.
There has been enforcement of a negative peace, of a pretending that nothing is wrong, of making, quote, both sides shut up and go to their corners and pretend that nothing's wrong. Well, that works for the Nazis because they know how the fuck to get around that, right? Like, that just gives them all the cover in the world. With furries, sweeping everything under the rug as, quote, drama, excusing every crime from murder and rape to fur affinity art theft is drama and all treated the same and erased. And so you get a situation. Eventually people are going to sort it out themselves, but then they turn around and they criminalize or they ban or they tisk and threaten the people who solve their own problem. That only makes their authority even more invalid and more useless. You know, I was threatened for standing up to this Tom guy in one of these chats, along with his ex-girlfriend who was calling him out in the public chat. We were both threatened with being banned. And I said, fine, ban me. I don't care. Do you know how much shit I've been banned from for speaking truth to authority? A lot. It's a hobby of mine. Banning the victims and defending the predators only reflects on your character, not mine. And he didn't ban me. He shut up. And maybe I actually got through to that one person. That's really what needs to be brought up on a societal level. Is if you don't let us solve the problem ourselves and you don't do anything about it, well, then your authority is invalid and we're just not going to listen to you. And that at the heart is what a revolution is. Whether it's a bourgeois revolution that doesn't actually replace anything but the chess pieces, like in the Arab Spring, or whether it's a legit proletarian revolution in which the working class actually liberates itself, the heart of a revolution is telling an authority, you're no longer valid and we're not listening to you.
The other thing that I wanted to cover with the police state, though, was this prison strike in Angola, Louisiana, which is kind of like in the corner where Louisiana and Mississippi kind of meet.
No, Andorra is a city.
It's Angola.
In Star Trek. It's Angola. Wait, the country is Angola or the city is Angola?
No, the name of the city in Louisiana that the prison are happening in is named Angola, which is also, if I recall correctly, like a country in Africa. But the other thing that makes this super ironic is this prison was converted from four plantations in 1880 into a prison and still produces corn and cotton using mostly black slave labor from inmates.
That totally checks. That totally checks. They fucking, in the South, they love using inmates for everything because you don't get to give them any rights. They make the perfect labor force for your own virtual slave.
Right, like, and if you don't go along...
To public buildings.
And there's a chapter in Hillary's What the Fuck Happened to Me book. In which she's talking about her time in the governor's mansion and talking about the slaves and how she's telling them that they're not doing her job. And she put this in her book. The private prison slaves who work in the governor's mansion. Like, she's telling them off and she put this in her book.
This is why real leftists don't take Hillary Clinton and neoliberals seriously, because they do this bullshit. Pardon my language, but that's what it is.
Excuse me, may I speak to your manager?
Oh my god, neoliberalism is literally just wanting to speak to capitalism's manager. Not even capitalism, just like the president's manager, whoever that is, to like get things done. And the I think that really nails it, right? Is that they don't take incarceration seriously. They don't take systemic problems as seriously as we do. When we see a system that's rotten, we understand what needs to happen to change it. You have to replace those rotten parts with things that are functional and democratic. Neoliberalism just wants to kind of paper over them, right? If they do talk about incarceration, it's only in the sense that, like, maybe they want to decriminalize things, but they would never really directly say that this basically preschool to prison to slavery pipeline is wrong. Because they had to have done something to get arrested, which is just the wrong way to look at it in the first place.
The reason that the whole work stoppage happened anyway is because these prisoners are treated to conditions that are just outright inhumane. It gets 90, 100, 110 degrees with 100% humidity in this area, and they're out busting rocks or picking cotton. And then when they're not doing that, they're being exploited for the local prison rodeo so that all the people from miles around town can come see them as part of some spectacle.
Yeah, it's very perverse. And I don't want to be too glib about it, because Angola is just one of many perversions of human rights and human freedoms.
And it's really ironic that this is named Angola, because Angola had a communist revolution that overthrew the colonizers, which then failed and revisioned in the 80s after the collapse or nearing the collapse of the Soviet Union. When the Soviet Union couldn't exert its ideology upon the rest of the world, there was a neoliberal velvet revolution and free elections, and labor lost all the power, and now they're just a tax shelter.
So when are we just going to storm the Bastille? When does that happen?
Okay. The teacher strike in Arizona, the path that they followed went right next to the city jail, which isn't that much of a jail. It's not out in the countryside. It doesn't have barbed wire. It's where they house people who get like 4 months sentencing, 6 months sentencing, community service, drunk overnight, a week in jail type thing. And is really a second home for homeless people, because those are always the kind of things they're arrested for. They're drunk in public, fall down, or like smash a window, arrested, charged, 6 months in jail. And that's a city jail. The strike's march path went right past, and I was just thinking, like, oh man, what if they like just stormed the jail right now? screw the teacher strike. Let's do that.
Yeah, Faolan. So like when you said storm the Bastille, my mind immediately went to like, yeah, when we just help prisoners take over the prisons and turn them into fortified locations, like that is going to be it. It's just an uprising of complete illegalism with no regard for the heinous system that has perpetuated this shit. Like we just take it over somehow. Like that's going to be storming the Bastille.
I do think, though, one of the most perverse things about the whole Angola story, though, was Billy Graham, the televangelist that is so beloved for his Christian philosophizing and pontificating. He had his casket hand-built by inmates from Angola.
And he'll ride that casket straight to hell. That's all I'm saying.
Our next topic here, the NRA appointed as president to their organization a man who is an expert at purchasing weapons. That's right. They got Oliver North to head up the NRA.
Yeah, my boy Ollie.
And I would just like to know, why is this guy not in jail? Like, seriously, if we're going to talk about people being in jail, this is the guy you need to throw in.
Yeah, I just want to talk to you guys about my Justice for Ollie project. This is my tour de force, all right? Ollie was just wrongly accused, all right? He was a stand-up dude. And so Justice for Ollie, I had a Patreon where people would donate, and they would get to say racist things on television for me. And we finally reached our stretch goal of $1 million. And the reward for that is Oliver North gets to be the head of the NRA. We put a lot of effort into this. And I'm so proud of all my patrons. If you don't mind, I'll list them off here while I've got the mic.
Is Foxler on the list?
He's one of my best patrons.
I would bet.
Shout out to my boy Foxy.
My boy Foxy.
Well, you know what they say about foxes in the fandom. They get kind of wild. So I'm just saying you might want to just hit him back up then and give him a special prize. I think he'd really enjoy that. But
I wonder if Foxler, like, puts guns up his ass.
Oh, God.
I can confirm that the $500 reward tier has one patron privately purchasing it, and you do get a firearm placed up your anal cavity. I won't say who, but... You know.
It's an airsoft gun that fires mini bad dragons.
It's a real gun that fires bad dragons.
I guess I could believe it. It's just like just grand irony, but it really goes to show what the NRA is about, because they're not really about Second Amendment freedoms, because if that were the case, they wouldn't have campaigned during the 80s and 90s for so-called responsible gun ownership, which, by the way, if you do that now, the NRA comes down on you. That was a dog whistle back in the 80s and 90s that they were pushing to basically close off the gun culture from African Americans.
It's sort of like the elephant in the room, right? Is that the reason the NRA hired Oliver North is because he's the best gun seller in the fucking world. He sold how many weapons to the Iranians during the Iran-Contra affair? I mean, the NRA must love this guy. He can sell weapons like none other. He got Reagan to peddle drugs just for these guns, okay? That guy has got a resume that puts any other fucking huckster to shame.
Right, and a lot of people just like seem to forget like the Iran-Contra thing was even a thing. And if you bring it up to people now, they're like, whoa, that's the wildest thing I ever heard. The United States sold weapons to the Iranians to fight what? The Iraqis so that mean? We could use the money to buy arms to Contras, which were counter-revolutionary, anti-communist, basically terrorists, actually, because they were fighting a democratically elected and popular supported government down there.
What do you mean we supported Osama bin Laden? What's this newspaper you're showing me where it talks about him as a U.S. ally? That guy's evil. That guy did 9/11. What do you mean America has a history of its allies biting it in the ass?
Yeah, so I'm starting another Patreon. It's the Give Iran a Nuke Patreon. It's basically the Iran-Contra scheme, except we're using it to get Iran a nuke instead. And we'll fund left-wing militias in the Central America.
This is a bad, bad idea. Let's... Wait, you're going to use the money to fund left-wing militias? Okay,
yeah, dude.
Now you can start talking. The interesting thing, though, about the whole Iran-Contra scandal was just how, like, if we're talking about the police state earlier, is that it fits right in there with the police state because it triangles. You have the selling the arms to the Iranians, using the money to supply the Contras, and then the Contras go in and they start growing coca plant to make crack cocaine, and then they flood the United States with crack cocaine, which then becomes the black drug that they use to go into the black neighborhoods, arrest people, and support the prison industry in the United States. So it's one big, giant military, industrial, prison industry complex. It's just, it's insane when you have to explain to somebody, and this is the guy that they got to head up the NRA, the guy that should be in jail perpetually for life for doing this, is the head of the NRA. And it goes to show how
he
morally
didn't even do it. He took the fall for Reagan, so Reagan wasn't impeached. Reagan's the one who did it.
Yeah, I'm glad Reagan's dead.
It just goes to show, though, how morally bankrupt the NRA is, that they picked this guy in the 80s and 90s. They supported reasonable gun legislation, which was really just a guise to basically deny African Americans their right to own a gun or use it in their own defense. And then once we're having schools shot up on a monthly or bi-weekly freaking basis here, that's overlooked simply because why? The perpetuators aren't African American, aren't Muslim for the most part.
There are newspaper drawings before newspapers could afford photographers of just after the Civil War, black people literally wading through deep southern rivers, holding rifles over their head to go to their polling place and vote.
I've seen those.
Also, my computer is about to die and I don't have an available plug. All of these stores are closed. And I've been around this area, and there's nowhere to plug it in. So, like, the rest of the show is probably going to be you and Fiber.
Sweet.
That works. Okay.
Okie dokie.
By the way, Attica is no longer with us. He did have to leave the thread here. So it's just me and Fiber for the rest of the night. So I'm enjoying that long, strong Fiber, if you will.
Call me.
I will. Attica's going to be mad because he thinks I'm saving myself for you. But he doesn't know because he's probably not listening.
Yeah, I'm your side piece.
Yeah.
Which I'm totally okay with.
Are you familiar with something called Godwin's Law?
Yeah, it's when people make fun of us because they're like, hey, you say Nazi all the time, but I bet you don't actually mean it.
So, exactly. So Godwin's Law is this idea that any conversation on the internet, if it lasts long enough, will eventually reach a comparison to Nazis or Hitler. And Mike Godwin has come out and said, you know that whole thing I said? Well, in this particular case with the alt-right, you're right to call them Nazis because that's exactly what they are. And even if they're not exactly that, they're comparable enough that the description is apt. And I thought that was a very interesting little detail there. Moving on, Middle East has just been on fire.
So a lot of our listeners will probably, I say our, I've just inserted myself into this podcast now, so you know, but a lot of your listeners probably know about the fact that we just shredded the Iran deal, right? Which is a humongous win for Boeing, Raytheon, Lockheed Martin, and just the entire defense contracting industry. Because it means that we are now on the warpath, or at least we're finding some fucked up reason to justify our paranoid fear that Iran will get a nuke. Because it'll make us a lot of money if they ever did, right? We could just colonize the shit out of them if they'd only do something that we are not allowed to let them do.
What this really means, though, is that they're just going to enforce an embargo, which basically is a war tactic. That's what an embargo is. The Iran deal is, or rather the repeal of the Iran deal is going to enforce sanctions, which have the goal of destabilizing the country economically during a time where they're already having protests and strikes and stuff like that. So they're definitely trying to collapse this country. And if they can't do that, then they'll go to war, or they'll have the CIA perform a color revolution or whatever to get whatever neoliberal dictator or other leader in there that will do their bidding.
I think the difference will be that if Syria has showed us anything, civil war and the era of the drone strike is radically different than anything we've ever seen. The days where we can imagine a front line with defined places where combat happens is over. It's insurrectionary, it's guerrilla, and it happens in the form of domestic terrorism that just explodes into outright warfare between just groups of people. I mean, we're not even talking like political ideologies or political factions. We're talking like families, neighborhoods, and just university students going to war, fighting each other. And the idea that you could stage a coup in Iran that would totally collapse, like the way that Syria's entire government has collapsed, is ridiculous and will lead to a loss of civilian life that will meet, if not exceed, what we've already seen in Syria so far. And that is something that should worry everyone.
Do you remember the Iraq sanctions and what Madeleine Albright said, I'd say about 10 years ago, when she was asked about it?
Remind me.
So Madeleine Albright said during an interview, I think it was on NBC, it was on one of the Sunday shows. They had asked her if she thought that the deaths were legitimate, if it could have been excused, because over half a million children died in Iraq due to the sanctions during the 1990s against Saddam Hussein. And she basically just cold-bloodedly just waved it all off and said, yeah, of course, you know, it was bad that the children had to die and everything, but it was worth it. And this was before the war.
Some of your children may die, but that is a decision I'm willing to make. What an unbelievable just...
And it goes to show, because this was under Clinton, it goes to show that it doesn't matter if it's a liberal Democrat in office or if it's a conservative Republican. These people, they're going to do what they're going to do. Imperialism is cold and cruel no matter the party or ideology that is in power.
And I think it corrupts every president. I've got a crack theory that I'll give to you, and maybe you can dispute it by just giving me some cold hard facts again, but I get the feeling that presidents, even the anti-war presidents that may come into office, are surrounded by people who have been at war for 16, 17 years now. And so when you're at war, you get a bunch of extra privileges. And I think the reality every president is hit with is like, no matter what you do, the people here are going to hate you. So you can kill them more and kick the can down the road, or you can stop killing them and they'll gain strength and hate you with the fire and fury of a nation state. And I think most presidents are like, I'd much rather kick the can down the road and kill some more kids so that I don't have to be the one who has more ISIS attacks happening. But then the reality is, the more we perpetuate this violence, the more we're just going to radicalize people within our borders. I mean, like, and it's not just going to be Muslims in our borders. It's going to be radicals from all sides of the spectrum who have to grow up under this gigantic war machine, and they'll kill people. I mean, that's just the sad reality of it.
And really, to top it off, all of this stuff with Iran couldn't happen at a worse time, because not only do you have this conflict going on in Syria, the Gaza situation has exploded. Israel is basically attacking full force the world's largest and most populated concentration camp, and that's exactly what this thing is. It's a giant death camp. These people, if Israel continues to do what they are doing, they will exterminate the Palestinians. That's what they want to do. And they believe that they have a divine right to do so, to create this greater Israel. And while not every Israeli prescribes to that notion, definitely the military elites there do. And that's scary. Bibi Netanyahu does.
Yeah, I think the word on everybody's lips when they hear this is genocide. And we'd like to think that we've moved on from an era of this, but if the Palestinian occupation is anything to go off of, it's not just genocide, it's Lebensraum. And I hate to say that, because there's some connotations that I might be calling it both sides. The citizens of Israel don't have the political power to oppose this. I mean, I've seen images of Israeli anti-fascists arm in arm with Palestinians, and this is during the shit going down. It is such a high stakes game that the leadership is playing, but they know that if they just keep pushing and taking over land, that they will win. I mean, the propaganda coming out is so extreme now that they've called disabled people who the army has rolled up on as enemy combatants. They know that they're losing the propaganda game, but if they just push hard enough, 30 years from now, they can just erase this from Israel's history. Israel was always Israel. That's the plan.
They shot a protester in the head for waving a flag about a month ago near the wall. He was near the wall. He wasn't at the wall. And the video is these soldiers doing it and then laughing about it afterwards, knowing what they had done, knowing that the guy was unarmed, that they could visually tell it, and they did it anyway, just for the show of it or the sport of it, and people will still defend them. And that's the terrible thing about this, is we have people that are willing, especially fundamentalist Christians in this country, that are willing to defend the policy of Lebensraum to literally for the purpose of creating or executing their own freaking doomsday policy. It's insane. And it's,
yeah, I think the thing that is most important for activists, organizers, and just the general public to understand is it's not like there's a border between Israel and Palestine anymore. Israel already occupies the West Bank and controls movement of Palestinians there. The Gaza Strip is slightly more free, but in terms of their access to resources, it's limited. And imagine being a protester, being shot by the IDF, and going to a hospital in Gaza. I mean, your chances are 50-50 at best.
Right, and a lot of people don't understand what Gaza is. Gaza is the size of the Portland city limits. Not the metro area, the city limits of Portland. It is that many square miles. I think it's like 38 square miles or something like that of land. I could be wrong. And instead of having, I think Portland officially has maybe 300,000 people living in its city limits. And there's a lot of people living around it. Gaza has 2 million people shoved into this tiny little strip of land. Not every part of Gaza is even accessible either, because there's actually now there's Israeli incursions into Gaza. So the whole strip isn't even all theirs anymore.
It's a humanitarian disaster. And if this keeps up, I mean, the idea of a two-state, I mean, I would say that the over-under on a two-state solution now would require a president to literally give up the pledge of protection to Israel and give it to Palestine, and threaten to regime change Israel, right? It would have to be the most radical left-wing president ever, and they'd also need a Congress of communists or just radical leftists, because things have become so dire that I don't think we can reverse this without the most radical of solutions. Israel unchecked will just occupy this territory just like we did to the Native Americans, and there are a lot of people living in America who recognize this. But there are a lot more who also don't. And those are the people we need to explain. This evokes the things we did in the Trail of Tears. And we need to prevent this historical massacre.
A lot of people also like to bandy about the term anti-Semitism anytime any criticism of Israel occurs whatsoever. When the fact of the matter is, one, the idea of Israel as a nation has historically been one of heresy among Judaism in modern times up until pretty much the 20th century there. Before that, it really wasn't a goal of theirs to do. This was a tenet of fundamentalist Christianity to create this. But the second thing is, even Jews in America and outside of Israel are condemning this now. They're saying that enough is enough. I actually saw a picture of, I don't know what it was. They were in the black outfits. They had the top hats and everything. It was, I think it may have been Orthodox. I don't know enough about Judaism to really say, but it was a group of that particular sect of Jews in New York, and they were holding up an Israeli flag and they burned it. That's the level that we have gotten to with the situation, that Jews around the world are telling Israel, no, stop. This is making us look bad. And then on top of that, it's just flat out wrong.
Yeah. Members of the BDS movement, I feel like I should at least say this. If Israel was Arabic and Palestine was Jewish, I would support Palestine. It has nothing to do with religion, at least not for me. It just comes down to, I'm watching history repeat itself, and these people are being slaughtered by the IDF. I mean, we have to at least reach a working peace, and it seems like that is so far on the horizon now that it's becoming a tragedy.
one of the last major news items that I wanted to end on here is the healthcare situation, actually. Speaking of just Nazism creeping into ideologies, a gubernatorial candidate, Christopher Barnett in Oklahoma, wrote on his Facebook page that he believed constituents using food stamps or the disabled should be euthanized. Like, this is outright eugenics.
My boy, Christopher Barnett, he's just... Man, we live in a wild time, right? Like, we live in hell world, where fascists are allowed to espouse their ideology, but calling them a fascist is too offensive for modern politics.
Okay, like, so he stepped over the board so much that he's no longer even a serious candidate. But the fact that he felt comfortable in doing it just kind of goes to show how far these people... It makes me wonder if there's not hidden threats out there that we don't know about that are running for office.
Yeah.
How many people are like this that we don't know about because they haven't outed themselves? And we kind of brushed on that earlier, but it's one thing if you're a cop, and it's another if you're democratically elected to the governorship of a state.
Yeah, we don't have to worry about those who are open about it. I think what we need to worry about is the constituents who are super okay with electing people who are comfortable with eugenics.
I mean,
I think it would just have to be, like, it's a personal failure on my activism, for sure, if someone in my home state who was a fascist got elected, right? Because, like, we have to take care of our own backyard in leftism. And if these folks are getting through, anti-fascists and union organizers and everyone on the left has utterly failed to provide an alternative that is more enticing than someone who's like, fuck your feelings, I'll kill your dog, I'll kill your daughter, but, like, we'll save a bunch of money for the government and your taxes will be lower. Like, if that's a palatable alternative then to what we're producing, it is an utter failure on our part, and we have to treat it as such.
Yeah, and it's amazing that a candidate was able to, or rather, somebody was able to become a candidate that is this extreme, and he outed himself. So now he's probably not going to make it because he's so extreme. Even his fellow Republicans said that they will not vote for him because of this. So he is that far out.
The funny thing is, they would have, right? They would have if it wasn't a problem. Like, if the media didn't pick up on this, like, they would have, right?
You know, I do think that there are people out there that fancy themselves as good people that are Republicans that know that that level of just outright fascism is wrong, and they're unwilling to go there. But what they don't understand is that the way fascism works is those are the people that either, one, get purged, or two, they're the people that incidentally help fascists obtain power because they apologize for them up until they out themselves.
Yeah, it's a snake with 100 heads. And it comes in a lot of different forms, right? Like, when we talk about fascism, I think one of the few valid criticisms that comes from the right of us, I don't think it necessarily comes from just the right, is, like, how many things do we call fascism? I would like to say that it's just a pan-authoritarian vibe that seems to echo through our culture in a ton of different forms.
I try to actually not use that particular term unless I'm talking about a few very specific things. So I will use it in the metaphorically in the case of, like, extreme right-wing opinions where it's authoritarian and obvious. But really, I like to use Mussolini's own definition of it. Not the one where he said, I am fascism, but there's another definition he gave where he said that fascism was the merger of corporate and state power. Basically, where corporations assume the state.
Well?
And I think that's a fair definition to start with because, I mean, that pretty much describes what happened in Italy and Nazi Germany to a T, pretty much. But the other things that I wanted to go over in the healthcare item, just kind of because it all ties into this idea of just people's lives being worth, you know, being valued, is a Goldman Sachs analyst actually asked the question in an article, is curing patients a sustainable business model? Ars Technica published this article. Just the fact that anybody, any business person, just has the audacity to go that far out.
I'm really surprised it hasn't happened sooner. And I know that might sound a little cynical, yeah, and it's kind of a hot take, but I mean, that must be the question in the room of every medical company, is like, is curing this disease profitable for the shareholders?
You know, I mean, bet that happens more often than people think, because we're not privy to what goes on in these boardrooms. We really don't know. And people like to demean people that spread these kind of things as conspiracy theories, when I actually think that there could be a legitimate reason that we've spent all this money trying to cure cancer and we haven't cured it yet.
Sorry, I hate to interrupt here, but I just realized that, like, when you talk about, like, right-wing, and especially right-wing libertarians, who they complain a lot about death panels, and we just have a verified death panel coming from the private industry.
That's exactly what it is. Well, that's exactly what this, like the Oklahoma governor, like, that's a death panel. Hey, he's literally saying who should live and who should die, and it's all based on how much money you have.
Yeah. Wow, sorry, that hit me like a truck.
I mean, or the nursing home in Louisiana, where they cut the funding for the residents there, and suddenly 30,000 nursing home patients, elderly people, are going to find themselves, what, out on the street, or?
Yeah, in my personal experience with nursing homes, things are already not great. They're for-profit enterprises, a lot of them, and they do accept insurance, private and public, but they're not hospitals. You don't get care. It's hospice that's sort of been made to scale. And they will put you on the street if you suddenly come down with something. I mean, a lot of the time, they'll just take you on an ambulance to the nearest hospital, and like, you come back if you can afford it and if you're healthy again. The nursing home is just an apartment complex that gives you, like, hospital beds. And so, I'm not surprised at all, but it is horrific that these 30,000 patients in Louisiana will be kicked out because Medicaid will have cuts. Because they'll either end up on the street, or they'll be taxing families that would not be able to handle them otherwise. Like, they'd be coming back to these homes and would be given worse care than a for-profit institution that cuts corners at every corner.
I think it's very telling of a society, how they treat their weak people and stuff like that. And it's very telling of the morals of our society when we have a whole political section whose answer is literally just become, let's kill off somebody's grandparents.
Yeah. As someone with grandparents that are in the nursing home system, this is my nightmare. Like, it's not because we wouldn't want them back in our homes. It's that they were already being taken care of, and now they are going to not be taken care of.
It seems like every step forward that we have, like, we did actually make a small step forward in our laws last week, with Trump announcing the repeal of pharmacy gag laws, which basically your pharmacist was required to not notify you if there was a generic product, and that law allowing that has been repealed. So the pharmacist can now let you know, oh yeah, I see you're taking whatever. Here's this other generic thing. It'll cost you less and everything. Or if you pay in cash for this, instead of it costing you $60, we actually really only charge $25 for this. It's just your insurance pays up to a certain amount. And, you know, we got a deal worked out for them. I didn't even realize this was a thing.
Me either, until I saw this.
And I was like, I was speechless when I saw it.
Yeah, in Washington, they automatically substitute your drug with a generic one if it's a cheaper cost. But at no point do they inform you on which generic you're receiving. which has led to a lot of situations where people have to get notes from doctors because they're getting a generic of something that's like life-threatening. Like, they had an allergy to the generic, but they were prescribed a name brand, which is another thing we could talk about.
Yeah, the other thing, though, that you do need to consider as well, ask your pharmacist first how much the drug costs, and then ask your pharmacist how much it costs on insurance. Because sometimes, in rare circumstances, depending on what the product is, it's actually cheaper for you to pay out of pocket than it is to have your insurance pay for it and pay it a copay. It's absolutely ridiculous. But the thing is, it's like, this was one step forward in an entire set of laws that was just one big bad package. Because in that same proposal that he's proposing, we're still lacking the pricing transparency overall. So whenever you go into a restaurant, you know how much a meal costs you. When you go to the hospital, you don't know how much a broken arm costs you, even though it's a procedure that they do all the time. And it's absurd. It's ridiculous. And then to top all of that off, Trump basically announced as well that he wants to take on other countries because they're not charging their people enough, and that's what's driving up the costs in the United States. So now it's not just enough that we don't have universal healthcare. He has to pressure drug companies and other countries into deals that they're just going to
ostensibly raise the prices of things that weren't before. I mean, a lot of people, they do a double take when I would tell them about this. They're like, wow, he's having the drug companies charge less, right? And it's no. He is going to bully other companies to charge more because those companies aren't making enough money. Like, they had been bullied before into giving discounts, which is absurd. And now we're gonna really fix this aggression towards companies, and they can charge as much as they want. Like, that was his opinion.
I did want to end on a bit of a high note here for you. I don't know if you'd heard, although you probably had, it's all over Twitter. Did you hear the allegation that Patch and Dio are in cahoots with Dragonear? And that obviously the reason that the neo-Nazis, the alt-furry, has been kicked off of Fur Affinity is because Patch and Dio are moderating Fur Affinity.
Yeah, you're going to need to talk to my lawyer about this. I think I've got to... I don't think I can talk about this. No.
Oh, so you're part of it too, is what you're saying.
Oh, yeah, all the leftists are, man. Did you not get the memo? Like, we organized this. Yeah.
Well, Dragonear...
Soros paid me. Oh, yeah. My God, my bank account, dude. I've never seen seven figures before. It was a great, great day for me and my shell company.
See, I missed it. I missed the email. I got the email from Dragonear. He's like, yo, you want to be a mod? You get to kick out all the Nazis. And I answered it too late, and the email disappeared from my inbox by the time I got back to it. So
yeah, I love how they think Dragonear, like the most like corrupt and yet totally like clueless and awful person who has like so many accusations against him, would give a shit about if there were Nazis on Fur Affinity. Like, it's much more likely that IMVU was just enforcing a content policy across all their platforms than any conspiracy these guys could cook up.
Okay. That said, this is the same group of people that sent photos of dead cats to Dragonear after his cat died. At a personal level, if I ran a website and a group of people on that website did that to me after I had a pet die, I would kick every single one of those guys off immediately. Like, there wouldn't even be question about it. There would have been, this happened and you're off.
I agree. It could totally be a personal motivation and they just got sick of it. I mean, it doesn't help that the Nazi furries are some of the most, I mean, they're a bunch of punks and not in the good definition of the word.
They're,
I mean,
just venomous people.
Venomous, yes. And they pretty much call everyone communists, which, I mean, makes Fur Affinity sound like a great place when it's really not. I mean, they say it's this whole like Jewish Zionist communist conspiracy going on there, just in everything.
Yeah, and I was informed that our Lord and Savior Dio is actually George Soros.
Yeah, Comrade Dio, Comrade Soros, yeah.
Yeah,
it's a fun game we play.
So
I'll never guess who Dragonear is.
I'm hoping, well, obviously he's the master of the Illuminati, or he's at least like 34th degree.
He's Hillary Clinton.
Oh yeah, like I said, at least 34th degree up there on that.
Totally, yeah.
I wanted to just kind of casually mention that going out here. So I guess we'll see you guys on the flip side. Hopefully, Fibersinthe, I'd really love to have you back on the show. If Eno was still here, I'd welcome him back on too. So I hope he's listening. And of course, Attica on every week.
Yeah, I love being here.
Yeah, well, thank you for being here. So I believe that that's going to be a wrap here for tonight. Till next week or just whenever. Good night and good luck.